Let's spend about 10 minutes talking Kansas State football, basketball, and recruiting on KSO Today, a free daily podcast brought to you by K-State Online. It is February 12, 2020. It is snowing outside like crazy, which is actually kind of cool, even though I'm really tired of the cold. And this is another edition of KSO Today, which is brought to you by both People State Bank and Legacy Insurance. Really appreciate our sponsors, as well as other sponsors, including Tallgrass Tap House, where we'll be with tomorrow night at 7 o'clock for another full-length edition of the KSO show that we do every Thursday there for K-State Online, of course. Appreciate you taking the time to listen to the show today. I've thought about this quite a bit, and I think I'm just going to talk about the K-State basketball season and what happened last night with Oklahoma State and Bramlage Coliseum. If you're listening to this, you're probably aware that K-State lost to the Cowboys last night, who did enter the game as the last place team in the Big 12. K-State falls 64-59 in Bramlage Coliseum to Oklahoma State to fall to last place in the Big 12. I just really want to talk through, you know, what this means, what's happened this season, my thoughts on it kind of going forward, because it's been, you know, absolutely a very, very disappointing season, to put it, you know, to put it lightly. I'll start with this, and this is not to brag and pat myself on the back, although I never mind, you know, bragging. I did pick Oklahoma State to win last night by 5. I had them 69-64. They ended up winning 64-59. The point of me saying that is it didn't surprise me. I had a feeling going into it that Oklahoma State was playing better than K-State the last couple of games. I think the Cowboys, not that this is about them, K-State certainly is the focus of this, but they've really underachieved this season. I think they're the most experienced team in the Big 12 coming back. So when I saw them, you know, they beat TCU, then played really well at Baylor. I know they'd played well in the SEC Challenge game that Coach Boynton had talked about last night. So anyway, I thought they were playing better, and I thought they would be the team without much pressure on them last night. I thought K-State would feel a lot of pressure to win in an unfriendly home environment, which is what happens when you're, you know, 9-13 going into it. And it didn't work out for K-State. The Wildcats fell to Oklahoma State 64-59 in a game that they didn't really have a good chance to win late, which we've said a lot lately. And it is what it is. K-State is now, you know, in last place in the Big 12, and it's impossible to ignore what the season has turned into. I thought when K-State went, you know, 2-4, and I talked about it on this show a lot too, when K-State went 2-4 against that stretch that had West Virginia twice, and they beat them once, and, you know, Baylor, and they were competitive, and Alabama, and they were competitive, and Oklahoma, and they beat them at home, and they had the one bad loss at Kansas, so they weren't competitive. I thought K-State was getting better, but the thing I talked about at that point was those performances were only going to matter when K-State started playing some of the lower-level or mid-level teams, even in the Big 12, they turned into wins, and that's not happened. You go to Iowa State, who had the same record as you do, and that's the game that, for me, I think really signaled that things were going to get perhaps even a little bit worse, and why I picked Oklahoma State in this one, because sure, K-State got back in it, but they found on 21 points to a really bad Iowa State team and then couldn't complete a comeback against that Iowa State team that didn't have its best player in Tyrese Haliburton, who's now out for the season, of course. So that game signaled to me that K-State's efforts in those six games against better opponents were not going to just carry over and turn into wins against worse teams. I was afraid the same would happen against Oklahoma State last night in Manhattan, and that's what did happen. I'll just run through the line real quick and talk through some of the players before getting back maybe to thinking more about the season and what it means for K-State. Mike McGurl was the saving grace for K-State last night, kept him close. 16 points, 5 of 9 from the field, 3 of 6 from 3. He did not turn it over in 31 minutes. He had 2 boards, 3 of 3 from the foul line. So K-State was 20 of 56 from the floor last night. Mike was 5 of 9. So you take him out, they're 15 of 67. Is that right? Yeah, 15 of 67 without him. From 3, K-State went 4 of 18 without Mike McGurl, 7 of 22 overall. From the free throw line, they would have gone 9 of 19 without Mike McGurl. They were 12 of 22 with him. So the shooting splits were really bad with him. The three-point split of 32% is okay. It's not great, but it's not killing you, like 54% from the foul line and 35% overall. But Mike McGurl had a very solid game for K-State last night, and he was sure despondent at the podium and postgame. Cartier Jada, 15 points, took 13 shots to do it, 2 of 6 from the field, 3 of 5 from the free throw line. He did grab 7 boards for K-State. I thought he played hard last night. He did have 5 turnovers, a team high, of course. 4 of those came from the first half when he actually turned it over in a pretty rapid succession. Then I was actually writing and giving him credit. He did not turn over once in the second half until there was 1.3 seconds left. So that fifth turnover, there was probably 30 minutes, you know, of floor time between turnover 4 and turnover 5. So he handled the ball well at that point. He played 36 minutes for K-State. David Sloan, 3 assists, no turnovers in 23 minutes, 4 points on 2 of 5. a fine effort from David Sloan, but not really noticeable. McCall Mawain, not bad again. 11 points, 6 boards in just 23 minutes. He did get a foul 25 seconds into the game, then another one 2 minutes and 15 seconds into the game to limit him to just 23 minutes. But he did go 11 points on 3-6 from the field, 5-8 from the free throw line, 6 boards. Again, if you took out Mac and Mike's free throw shooting, though Mawain's was just 5-8. But in his field goal shooting, K-State's becomes just abysmal. Xavier Sneed, 8 points, 3 of 11 from the field. Continues to struggle shooting the basketball, 2-4 from the field, or from the three-point line, not bad. Does not get to the foul line once, which I will say the officials were not a problem last night. They didn't cost the game. It's not where I'm going. He should have got to the foul line at least once. He drew a lot of contact near the rim. 4 boards, 3 assists, just 1 turnover in 31 minutes for Xavier Sneed. Dejuan Gordon, certainly struggling. I think he's working through some stuff. I've noticed the last 3 games, Dejuan is working out on the bike for extended periods of time before warmups, I think he's really working to keep his leg loose and struggling a little bit right now. Just 2 points, 1-4 from the field. He turned it over twice in 17 minutes. Probably his worst game so far. Not going to pile on him necessarily at this point either. Just a young guy, and I think he's dealing through some stuff. But the freshman really struggled last night. Add on Antonio Gordon, 0 points on 0 of 2. Montavious Murphy, 1 point on 0 of 4. So they combined to go 1 of 10. So much as I praise Mike and those other guys, if you take away the freshman's 1 of 10 and then 0 of 4 from 3, those numbers start to look a bit better too. They only provided as a group 3 boards, and they turned it over twice. So Levi Stockard got 10 minutes last night, 2 points, 2 boards, 2 turnovers in 10 minutes. That's what happened. That's the line by line of it. But back to the big picture of it. You know, I think if you're a K-State fan, I really have tried to learn and teach myself over the last 5 to 6 months. My job as a writer or a guy on a podcast is not to tell you how to feel. So I stay pretty quiet on the emotional stuff or what the big picture reaction is to some of those things. And you should feel how you want to feel. This is a coaching staff that on the positive side has been very successful the last 7 years, has won a couple of Big 12s, has gone to an Elite 8, has a very good recruiting class coming in, and is probably going to make this program good again over the next, 2-3 years. That's something to be positive about and appreciate. On the flip side, you don't have to sit there and be happy, when a year is as bad as this year. I will say, I've said this before, if you're one of those fans who says, I just care about winning championships and you can blow it up in the other years, I've seen, Gary Patterson referenced a lot of how you would love to have a Gary Patterson. I don't care if he has years when I go 4-8 if I'm winning the Big 12 so often. Well, that's what you're getting in Bruce Weber right now, a guy who wins the Big 12 every so often. In the years when he doesn't, sometimes it absolutely blows up. So if you are a championship or bust guy, you're getting championships or bust at the conference level with Bruce Weber. And that's, not a joke. I think it's something that some people have to actually understand if that's their stance, that they maybe shouldn't be so harsh about it. If you're not one of those people and you're somebody who believes every season matters and every win matters and every game matters, then yeah, you've got to be very, very frustrated at a season where you're going to go from potentially first to worst in the Big 12. And it seems to be getting a little bit worse, to be quite honest. I think K-State played well in that stretch I talked about. Now it's gone bad. You're going to play another pretty bad team, to be quite honest, in TCU this Saturday in Fort Worth. K-State Online will head down there, of course. I'll be down there in Fort Worth to cover the game. And we'll see what happens with it, of course. K-State, to avoid a really, really embarrassing season, is going to have to start stringing together some wins, and I think it's becoming less and less likely after every one of these losses. There is still some talent on this team. They do continue to play hard. They do continue to care about their coaching staff and vice versa. They care about the players. So I don't think you're going to see this team mail it in or quit or stop being competitive. And maybe I'll feel stupid in a couple of weeks when they win a couple of games and I have to talk about being wrong about this thing going as bad as it has. But the reality is I don't feel good about where it's gone this year. At this point, I don't see it magically turning around in K-State even having a borderline respectable Big 12 season. I think it's going to be a really tough finish to the season, and I'll be interested to see how the players handle it. Mike McGurl, like I said, was just despondent in postgame last night, and he had a reason to be. I'm not criticizing the kid. He played very hard. He cares a lot, like they all do, like Cartier Jada does, like Xavier Sneed does, all the way down the line through Levi Stockard, Pearson, McAtee, Joe Patricus, all those guys. So I do feel for them. I do feel for the coaches when I see them, people hurting like that, even though as a media member, shouldn't be how you feel. It is how I feel. But I also feel for the fans who are really, really struggling through this right now and have to deal with their team turning in such a uninspiring season, and it's been really hard for them to get behind, which I understand. That does wrap up today's edition of KSO Today, which was all about K-State basketball. You'll see plenty more recruiting and football coverage on the site in the days going forward. DY has some stuff in the admin. I have to jump in and edit now from K-State football recruiting perspective. And as we get closer, to spring football and thinking about that, you're going to start seeing more and more football coverage on the site, as well as more travel from us. We are 9 days away from hitting the road, I believe. Maybe it's 8 days to see Davion Bradford and Luke Kasubke. So we'll have that coming up soon. And we'll continue to do more recruiting travel, I believe, around the Big 12 tournament. But we'll do it for the football side instead. Thank you for listening. Thank you to our sponsors. I appreciate People State Bank and Legacy Insurance. Appreciate your time as subscribers, people who watch this show. Listen to the show, I guess, is more accurate because there's not a lot to watch, but I do appreciate your time. You have other things you could be doing with it. So thank you. Enjoy your day, and we'll see you back here tomorrow on KSO Today.